This next slide indicates the second method of becoming infected. It's called indirect transmission. Here the virus has settled on and contaminates an object on the surface. You touch the surface or picking up the object, and then your hands subconsciously touch your eyes, nose, or mouth. You have now put the virus from your hands and into these mucosal surfaces, and you have become infected. This is why we want you to wash your hands frequently and why we advise cleaning the surfaces that people frequently touch. Sticking with our visual image, let me offer an example of how someone could get indirectly infected by another person. After this other child has touched this football, if they then touch their eyes, nose, or mouth, they could become infected with the influenza virus. This is why we advise people to wash their hands frequently. Actually, it is important to understand that there is no cloud around the object or the surface. The virus sits and stays on the surface of the object, so you must touch the surface of the object to pick up the virus. So far there have been no twist to between seasonal flu and swine flu. So let's look at what happens after you get exposed. What determines if you get infected, and what determines the severity of the illness you get? Who will become infected and who gets sickest? Who is more likely to become seriously ill? For infection and illness with influenza, there are two main factors. First, there must be an exposure. So therefore, the key is to watch your 3 to 6 foot personal space and wash your hands frequently. The second factor that determines whether you become infected is, do you have immunity? Can you fight off the virus? Did you get infected with the same or a similar strain in the last few years, or did you get vaccinated? Since about 40% of the public in the United States gets vaccinated, and about 20% will become infected in the last year or two, that leaves about 40% of our population vulnerable during a typical seasonal flu year. So here's our first twist with 2009 swine flu. Since this surface of this new virus is so different, about 90% of the population is vulnerable, and they lack immunity. The only group that may have some partial immunity are those who are over 60 years old. They were children in 1957, the last year this or a very similar virus to this one was around. Next, let's look at the two factors that determine the severity of your influenza illness. The first is the characteristic of the virus itself. The good news is that 2009 swine flu has about the same level of severity as seasonal flu, and it is not becoming more deadly over the past few months. While this is reassuring, we cannot forget that influenza is unpredictable, so we must keep monitoring. Second, and probably the most important factor that determines the severity of the illness, is your own personal health. There are groups that if they get infected, they are at increased risk for serious influenza. There are two main situations that influence how sick you can become. The first is how strong or how robust is your immune system. How well does your immune system work? How well can you fight off any infection? The second is, do you have an underlying medical condition that really doesn't react well to any other infection, particularly influenza? So let's look at our list. Those that are at high risk because they have a weakened immune system are pregnant women, children that are very young, less than 2 years old, and also at the bottom here, those that have transplants and HIV disease. Those at high risk because they have underlying diseases include asthmatics, and those that have heart disease or heart failure, and particularly neurologic conditions. Now, let's next talk about the actual influenza illness itself. After you get exposed and you become infected, how do most people feel? We call this an influenza-like illness because there are many other types of respiratory viruses that can cause you to feel the same. Classic influenza has an abrupt fever, cough, and a severe backache. Swine flu, the twist here is it is often milder, and it lasts about 72 hours. Typically, you have a temperature that is over 100 degrees, plus a cough, sore throat, or maybe some nasal congestion. Up to a fourth of the people will have stomach problems, such as nausea and diarrhea, and body aches, but they're not as severe as classic influenza. Another twist is that the office tests are unreliable. When you get swine flu, when should you go to see the doctor? Particularly if you or your child are not eating or drinking, or are struggling to breathe, or having a hard time to wake up. The basic treatment remains rest, recuperate, and fluids. Antivirals can be prescribed for those that have high risk. And let's recall those: pregnant women, children under the age of 2, or children over the age of 5 with an illness, asthmatics, adults over the age of 65, and those with the following underlying medical conditions. These are all people who should consider the use of antivirals like Tamiflu or Relenza in the event that they develop symptoms. Swine flu is the same as seasonal flu, and the incubation period is approximately 3 to 5 days. That means that when you become sick, sometime in the last 3 to 5 days, you are exposed either directly or indirectly by someone who had the virus. Most people don't remember who that person was. The infectious period, which is critical to how long you should stay away from others, begins actually one day before you become sick and then lasts up to 5 to 7 days after the onset. But as we said earlier, your infectivity drops very dramatically after your fever goes away. We ask all people who are sick with an influenza-like illness to voluntarily isolate themselves, stay away from others, until their fever and cough has been absent for 24 hours. There's actually no reason or no possibility, really, for your doctor to clear you to return to work or school.